It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Soon the bells will start. And the thing that'll make them ring is a carol that you sing right within your heart.
Well, hi, everyone. Hey, and Merry Christmas. Welcome to Central. My name is Cal Jernigan. I'm the lead pastor here, and it is a joy and a delight to have you in our services today, and we're seriously so glad that you're here. Now, you might be looking at this going, I don't think he's in Arizona. Folks, we're not in Arizona. We're actually in Canada, and we're in a place called Whistler, and I don't know if you've ever been here, but Whistler is on the west side of Canada. It's up above Vancouver, and it is a picture-perfect place. Now, most people come to Whistler because of the kind of premier alpine skiing that it offers. That's not how I ended up here. I ended up here a number of years ago. I was asked to speak at an event, and so I came up here and brought Lisa with me, and it happened to be Christmas time, and we were, shocked by how incredible this place is. And from that day to this day, I've always wanted to come back. And so I've talked to people, I've told people, because when you experience something like that remarkable, you talk about it. And so I've asked people, have you ever been to Canada, to Whistler at Christmas? And obviously most people would say no, but I just kept talking about it. Well, eventually we made a decision. We need to do something. If we can't bring all of you, which would be the ideal thing, let's all come up here to Whistler and have Christmas up here. If we can't do that, the next best thing we can do is bring Whistler to you. And that's what we're doing, and that's where these images are coming from and why we're doing it. As I said, it is the most picture-perfect Christmas sight. Now, but let me stop. Let me say this. When you picture the perfect Christmas, what comes to your mind? What is it that makes Christmas perfect? Where would it be? How would it be? What would be involved? Would you be at home? Would you be in the mountains? Would you be by a beach? Where would you be? And like, imagine, like, what would make it perfect? The setting would have to do with it. The people would have something to do with it. Obviously, there'd be people you'd have to have there, and there'd be people you really weren't there. But the truth of the matter is that there's an image in your mind of the perfect Christmas. Picture perfect. And so if you'll do that, you'd be thinking about that. That's what we're gonna talk about today. And we're just gonna continue in a spirit of celebration. Right now, I'm gonna ask you to do something. I'm gonna ask you to rise to your feet. Here's why, because we're about to sing Christmas carols, because Christmas can't be Christmas without singing. And so I just wanna encourage you, get on your feet. They're gonna lead us a couple of Christmas carols, and then I'll be back and share a little bit more with you.
Merry Christmas, Central. Hey, we're going to sing today. And let me tell you, we have a reason to sing, for King Jesus is born. Would you put your hands together with me? Come on, just like this. Let's sing some carols.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I love the fact that we come together to celebrate Jesus coming near, that He is the name above all other names. As we think about this baby being born, He would get the name of Wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, Mighty God, Emmanuel. What a wonderful proclamation, what a wonderful promise that we have, and what a great way that we could really connect with who God is, because God is an incredible God. I'm reminded of a story. One of our pastors participated in an event that we do every single year here at Central. We call it Fill the Slay. And Fill the Slay is a wonderful effort that we want to share the love of Christ by providing gifts for families in need all throughout our community across all of our campuses. And it's a wonderful thing we encourage families to do with little ones. And one of our pastors on staff took her little girl, Elliot. And Elliot was really excited to pick out all these gifts. But Elliot failed to realize one important fact, that these gifts that she was selecting were not for her. And it was just a really interesting thing as that little girl, Elliot, was so upset. But then she realized what she was doing and why she was doing it. And her response went from tears of joy. Here's a picture of her right here. Isn't it a good visual to watch that happen, to see someone capture what it means to be generous? That God invites us into that. In fact, God is the most generous of everyone, because God gave us His Son, Jesus Christ. What an incredible gesture. It says in Acts chapter 20, verse 35, blessed to give than it is to receive. I love the visual of that. I love the promise of that, because so often we forget that important truth. We see it during Christmas time, right? We buy gifts for someone. We can't wait for someone to open up the gift that you bought for them. See, God invites us to be a part of something bigger than ourselves. Now, what a wonderful way, because Him being a generous God, we get a chance to follow His suit, follow His example. And many of us in this room are generous, and we took on the weekly discipline to give of our time and our efforts and our energy to make sure that Central functions. And because of that generosity, we're able to reach more people for Christ. Now, if you are a guest here today, your gift to us is you being here. And our gift to you is this service. But what a wonderful reminder for those of us who call Central home to be a part of something bigger than ourselves. As this is a weekend service for all of us, we continue to see His kingdom come and see His will be done. So this Jesus was also a sacrifice. He also was a sacrifice. I'm reminded of a story, a historical event that happened in Luke chapter 2. In verse 22, where Jesus' parents were taking Jesus to be dedicated. And a guy by the name of Simeon had some incredible interaction with Jesus. He says this in verse 29. I love how this goes on, because it's such a wonderful way that we could see and have a different perspective of who God is. I love what it says in the beginning, verse 22. Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. See, Simeon recognized the Messiah. We recognize what He has done for in His cross. This Jesus now would go to the cross and die for us. So when you came in, you received the symbols representing the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. We're going to take these elements together as a church family. You see, when Jesus took the bread, He asked all followers of Him to take the bread and eat it. This bread represented the body that would be hung on the cross. So now we take. And then He took the cup, and His cup represented the sign of the new covenant, the blood that was shed, the ultimate sacrifice. And Jesus commanded all followers of Him to take this and drink. Let's pray together. Most Heavenly Father, we thank You for You being an incredible God that You are. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you, wonderful counselor, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, mighty God, Emmanuel. We thank you, Lord, for this moment. We thank you for what you invite us in to be. We thank you, Lord, for what you've done for us through your Son, Jesus Christ. And we thank you, Lord, for this moment and this time. We celebrate your arrival. We celebrate who you are. And we thank you so much, Lord, for this moment in which we give thanks for your death, your burial, and your resurrection. We pray this in your holy, precious name. Amen.
Hi, everyone. Hey, Pastor Cal here again. Man, thanks for singing and worshiping with us. We're back in picture perfect Whistler. And as I said before, man, I wish so badly that you could all be here. The idea of this moment I want to spend with you is if you were here and we were just sitting across a table in a cozy cafe, having a cup of coffee and just talking among friends. And I'm not going to preach a sermon. I just want to share some thoughts that I hope will kind of give you something to reflect on as you celebrate this Christmas with your family. Earlier, I asked you to imagine, you know, what would your perfect Christmas be? Where, you know, where would it be? And how, you know, just dreaming about that, the perfect Christmas for you. And I don't know where that would be for you. Maybe it would be just at home. I just want to be at home. That would be the perfect location. You know, everything in my house is decorated. Man, everything, get my family there. Get like the smells of Christmas, the fresh cut Christmas tree, the chocolate chip cookies, you know, the sit down with your family, have that meal that you normally have. And the perfect Christmas might be the dishes automatically wash themselves. I don't know. But that might be the perfect place for you. Some of you would go, no, you know what? I grew up and there was always snow and we would shovel snow and the driveway would be, you know, it's kind of first thing we'd have to do. And your idea would maybe be more in the mountains. I don't know. Snow falling, it's kind of cold, you know. You're gathered together with your family inside. You got a fire roaring in the fireplace. Christmas carols maybe playing in the background. Maybe for some of you, it might be not at home, not at a cabin. It would be, man, I want to be in Hawaii, man. I want to be laying out on a beach. I want to, you know, white sands and palm trees and no cloud in the sky, waves crashing, you know, and you're singing Melikaliki Maka. You know, that's kind of like, that's Christmas and that's what it ought to be. And I don't have any idea what it is that you think of that would just be the absolute perfect Christmas for you. But I want to ask you a different question. Not where would it be, but what was your best Christmas? What was the best Christmas you ever had? Who was there? Where were you? What made that thing so special? And as you think about that, I want to ask you again just a simple question. Was it perfect? You go, oh, it was so perfect. Was it really perfect? And my guess is no, it wasn't perfect. It was really, really good, but it was a little bit, it would have been better if. And see, the reason I'm trying to get you to think about this is that so often what happens to us when it comes to Christmas is we're striving and we're reaching for like the perfect Christmas. Everything's got to be perfect for it to be the best. And I want to challenge you to think about that. I want to talk about, because again, picture perfect. I want you to picture perfect. Because I think sometimes we have a picture in our mind of what Christmas ought to be that it's not very realistic and it can leave us disappointed and dissatisfied when God was trying to give us something. I want to read to you from the Gospel of Luke, the Christmas story. I know you know this story, and again, I've said this so many Christmases. The first time I ever heard this was watching Linus on a Charlie Brown Christmas when I was the Yatal.
And there were in the same country shepherds, abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night, and lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them.
First time I'd ever heard it, and I just remember being riveted to what he said. I had never heard these words before. I want to explain to you God's idea of a perfect Christmas. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth to Galilee, to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David. because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord, and this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off, and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up and pondered all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had seen, heard, and seen, which were just as they had been told. I don't know about you, but there's a lot with that story. So beautiful, but it's far from perfect. You know, it's interesting how over the years, people have tried to make it, you know, a little bit more palatable, a little bit more appealing, because when you really read the details, well, so we sing songs, you know, "Away in a Manger." We talk about the stars, you know, up in the sky, and, you know, beautiful night, and, you know, the little baby Jesus lying in the hay, the cattle are lowing, but the baby is perfect, man, no crying out of that little baby. How many newborn babies have you ever been around that didn't cry? So we try to glorify this, we try to idealize it, we try to make it better than it is. You know, there's so many parts of that, you'd have to go, "I got some questions about that." But then first, what about Mary? She's the one who's going to be given the task of raising this child. The whole thing about how the conception was going to happen, what we know is the virgin birth, you know, this immaculate thing that was going to happen with her, and the Holy Spirit was going to overshadow her. And you just go, okay, that's kind of weird a little bit. The Roman governor declares a census. Of all the times that the governor could declare a census, he chooses to do it right now, which forces this young couple to travel. He can't leave her because she's about to give birth. So they have to get over from up north in Galilee over to Bethlehem, which is south. And again, there's no bus, there's no Uber to call. That means hop on a donkey and travel or walk it. It's like, you gotta be kidding. But that's what they had to do to get down there. No family to meet them, to be with them, no doctor. To deliver the child, no sanitary hospital to check into where she could be taken care of, and no one gives up a room. There's no room in an inn. So somebody, maybe out of an act of kindness, I don't know, somebody suggests, well, you know, there's a barn out back, probably a cave, but it's where the animals are kept. And there's nothing in us that's appealing about that. You understand the unsanitary nature of that. So this baby is laid in a manger is a feeding trough for animals. And then in that story, shepherds show up. And it sounds so cool because the shepherds show up and they're cool. Here's what you've got to understand about shepherds in that area at that time in history. They were considered really outcasts. They were not the cream of the crop of society. They were the low folks that nobody wanted to hang out. They were despised because they smelled funny. They had a bad reputation. They would not even be allowed to testify in court if they saw something because they were just shepherds. But shepherds, they show up. That's really awesome. You got a crazy political leader named Herod who's trying to kill off all the babies in Bethlehem because he's threatened by the birth of this child. There's like a manhunt going on, a little baby hunt, and all these babies get slaughtered. You know, the only really cool thing you can come up with about this story. Well, there's two that I can think of. I mean, come on, that whole thing about the angels and and the heavenly hosts of angels out in the fields at night. Okay, that was awesome. And then there's that other thing that's just super cool, which is God came to earth, became one of us. Okay, that thing, of course that's cool. That's the point of the story. If you were God and you're perfect and you have all power and like literally you're the Lord of the universe, you created everything, is this the best you got? If you were aiming at perfection as God, is this the best that you could do? I mean, if the bullseye was perfection, it seems like you aimed pretty low as you hit this actual point. Let me just explain something. Outside of God, perfect doesn't exist. Outside of God, perfect doesn't exist. There's no place on earth, there's no time in history where you could truly say that everything is perfect. It doesn't exist. Aiming at perfection, by the way, is aiming at a very, very small target. Because if there is a point of perfection, it's only a point. It's just a very little point. If you're aiming for perfection, a whole lot of good has to be discounted as not so important, not so good, not so significant, not so worthy. And honestly, if you're pursuing perfection, you're paying a huge price. So we want to, everything's got to be perfect. But the God of the universe, the perfect creator, when bringing his son to earth, told the story this way, set the stage this way. Kind of strikes me that Christ came to earth the way he did, in such an imperfect way, because you and I, we're as imperfect as we are. And you know what? It fits us perfectly. The story fits us perfectly. Let me read to you a couple of passages. John 3:16, you know this passage. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. So this is just a gift from God. This whole thing, this whole story, it's just a gift. That Jesus came this way to us at this time, it's a gift. Let me read to you 2 Corinthians 5:21. Hopefully it'll sharpen the focus a little bit. God made him who had no sin to be sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God. In other words, God exchanged his perfection for my and your imperfection. It was his way of saying, I'll meet you where you are, not where I am. I'll meet you where you are. See, here's the point. God isn't looking for perfection out of you. He's not looking for perfection. So many of us think that that's exactly what we have to have a relationship with God. We have to be perfect. We have to live in that place of perfect. I just need to tell you, God's not looking for your perfection. God knows you who you are. See, our imperfection drives us away from God when really what it ought to do is exactly the opposite. Our imperfection ought to draw us towards God because we realize that he realizes what we are and what we're not. Scripture is very clear. Our righteousness is nothing, which means however good you are, and I'm sure you're really, really good, but no matter how good you are, whether you're the kind of person that never thinks about God except for once or twice a year, or you're the person that goes to church every single weekend of every year, I need you to understand something. All of us, in fact, let me read to you another passage. This comes from Isaiah 64:6. All of us have become like one who is unclean. And all of our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away. I'm so imperfect. You're so imperfect. This perfect God came to earth to meet us where we are. And he did it in an imperfect way because that fits the setting best. That's the perfect way to do this. So you go, well, if God doesn't want my perfection, what does he want from me? Okay, don't miss this. Don't miss this. You know what God wants from you? Not your perfection, but he wants your presence. That's what he wants from you. He wants to be with you. He came here because you're here. He came here because that's how he could have a relationship with us. And that's what he wants from us. And if your imperfection is driving you away from his presence, you're missing the point that he wanted you to get. He loves you for who you are, and he loves you for how you are. Now, the problem, I think, for so many of us when it comes to Christmas is, hey, man, Christmas is so busy. There's so many things to do. I got stuff to do. I got places to be. And even as you're here, you know, as you're sitting in church right now, experiencing this or online, wherever you are, it might be like, are we almost done? You see, you can be here but not be here. You're here, but you're not here. You're here and all you're doing, you're thinking about what's at home. You're thinking about what you got to do yet tonight. You got to think, I got to put that thing together. I got to wrap those presents. I got to get that thing in the oven. You're missing the moment. The perfect moment to be with God is right now. And he's come all of this way to be with you. Are you hurrying through your life? Are you hurrying through the season? Please don't do that. Just slow down. Be here right now in this moment. You know, it's interesting. A psychologist a while back, a guy named William Moulton Marston, he asked 3,000 people, what have you to live for? What have you to live for? And you know what he found that was fascinating? 94% of people that he asked, of these 3,000 people, said they were living for something that's yet to be. Not this moment, not now. And some of the things that were on his list, waiting for the children to grow up and leave home, waiting for the next year to begin, waiting for another time to travel this long-dreamed vacation that we've wanted, you know, waiting for tomorrow, waiting to feel like I want to do something with my waiting, but you're missing the moment while you're just waiting for the next moment to come. The presence of God to us is a kind way of saying, you know what, he would really enjoy your presence. Too many of us, we miss the moment. One of my favorite readings, I've read this in Christmases past, it's called I Never Got What I Wanted. It was spring, but it was summer I wanted. The warm days and the great outdoors. It was summer, but it was fall that I wanted. The colorful leaves and the cool dry air. It was fall, but it was winter I wanted. The beautiful snow and the joy of the holiday season. It was winter, but it was spring I wanted. The warmth and the blossoming of nature. I was a child, but it was adulthood I wanted. The freedom, the respect. I was 20, but it was 30 I wanted. To be mature and sophisticated. I was middle-aged, but it was 20 that I wanted. The youth and the free spirit. I was retired, but it was middle age I wanted. The presence of mind without limitations. My life is over and I got nothing that I wanted. I want you to understand God has a present for you, P-R-E-S-E-N-T, and that is that he doesn't expect you to be perfect. But you know what he does want? He wants your presence because he wants you. He loves you that much and he wants to be with you. If you could picture what I'm explaining right now, if you could picture this, oh, that would be perfect. Now pray with me if you would. Father, thank you for the moment that we get to share together. We'll never have this moment again. I know sadly, and again, when none of us have any idea who, but this will be some people's last Christmas. God, may we not miss the moment. It'll be our last one, maybe, I don't know, maybe mine. It will be the last time that we're all going to be in this room we're in. It'll be maybe the last time these families will be together as families. God, I don't know what the future holds. I do know that the future is in your hands, though. But God, what you gave us is right now, the perfect gift, this moment. But God, we can't miss it because we're in such a hurry to get to the next one. Now, Father, we confess our imperfections. We know that you came to die for us because we needed that. And that Christmas is literally celebrating the beginning of a story that in a couple of months we'll celebrate the tragic conclusion, which we say tragic, but really it opened up all of heaven for us with what we celebrated Easter. But God, it's a story. It starts here. And Lord, thank you for our time together. Please, again, slow us down. May we take advantage of every moment you've given us right now. So in your name, we pray. Amen. In our church, there are very few things that we do that we would say are our traditions. We don't have a whole lot of traditions as a family. We have certain things, though, that we really do cherish, and we're about together to experience one of them, and that is the lighting of the candles at Christmas. And I want to encourage you to take that candle and just hold it and just kind of look at it. Let me explain the significance of why we do this. What matters is that into the darkness came a light. And that light is what we have been celebrating in this service, the light of Jesus Christ, the perfect solution to imperfect people's problems. And Jesus came so that you no longer have to stumble along in the darkness. And in darkness, we don't know where to go. We don't know how to find our way. Jesus came to show you the way home, to literally set a light in front of you so that your path would be lit. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to turn this over to the campus pastors on each of our campuses, and they're going to walk you through just this wonderful moment and watch what happens in each of our worship centers as this perfect light of God spreads among imperfect people who are focused on wanting to live our life for His life. Bless you. Watch this.
And as Pastor Cal shared, this is the Christ candle. And the light has entered in to the darkness. And what's even incredible as well is that we are called to share this light with others. The light has entered into the darkness, and this light is the hope and the love of what God intends for us to have and experience. Now, what will happen now as the ushers come down and light your candle, we want you to share that light with others. And as you have your candle lit, we ask you to light the other candle next to you, and we all will stand and we will sing Silent Night, Holy Night. What a wonderful visual we're about to experience as we see this room that is now dark be overwhelmed by the light of Christ. So let's sing together Silent Night, Holy Night.
every voice, silent night.
Before you are seated, raise your candle and look around the room. It all started with one candle. And this is what the church looks like when that love and that hope and that light is shared with others. Now, before you are seated, for the safety of those around you, be mindful of the hot wax and please extinguish your candle. You may be seated. If you would like to hold on to this moment and share this, you're more than welcome to take the candle home with you. But as we leave here, there'll be red bins located at all the exits for you to place your extinguished candles in those containers. What a wonderful moment we've shared together. It's such an honor to be a part of a tradition that we've been doing for so many years. And just a couple of things I want to let you know about before you dismiss. If you are a guest here today, we are thrilled that you are here as well. Be sure to stop by one of our new here tents where we would like to meet you and hear your story. And we just would love to honor you and get a chance to meet you. And a couple of things I want to let you know about. Next week, we will have no in-person services. So that means on Thursday, December 28th, and on Sunday, December 31st, we will not have any in-person services. But in place of that, we have a special online service for you on Saturday, December 30th, and then Sunday, December 31st. And so what a wonderful way that you could still join us as we continue in our series at Christmas at the Movies. And so I'm so thrilled about that. So thrilled about that, am I, is that we have a special gift for all of our families here. So we have a gift for you so that you can enjoy your time of watching these movies in the comfort of your own home with loved ones and family members. And so our only ask is we have remaining services that you take one gift per family. One gift per family. So there are other services because we don't want to be a Grinch, okay? So we want to make sure that everyone can enjoy that time together. And then there's a lot of great things that are happening here outside. And so I hope you got a chance to see, but we have a scavenger hunt. We have an incredibly creative photo booth. I saw some of you guys making some really fun pictures and memories together. I encourage you to stick around. Don't run off. There's a lot of great things. There's hot chocolate available for you, so you don't want to miss that. Don't hurry off. Stick around. And besides, you're going to go home to chaos anyway. So stay here and in the peaceful time of this and sharing this moment with us. And so you're more than welcome to be a part of that. And then as we think about this time, we know that this Christmas time can be difficult for some. And we'll let you to know that we see you. Our prayer team is here for you. They'd like to pray for you. If you would like to know what it means to be a follower of Christ and like to begin that journey, our prayer team would love to come alongside you and answer any questions that you may have about that. So if you have answered prayers, we just believe in prayer here as a church. So with that being said, this concludes our service. God bless you. Be the church. And on behalf of Central Christian Church, Merry Christmas. And we'll see you again soon, you guys. Bye-bye.
Thank you.